Hey, buddy.
Hey, what's up? Okay, I need you on the show. What's going on? You're live. Bitcoin price, cryptocurrency, crypto markets. I'll read some headlines. Bitcoin price and crypto markets crash. Market suffers 15% drop in weak Bitcoin. Cash getting smashed. What is happening, buddy?
Well, like I said a long time ago, or not a long time ago, but last time we spoke was basically that the 6,000 price was like the whole mining cost meme, and like a lot of people were thinking that, you know, 6,000 is going to hold forever, and it just, it was very unlikely. And like I've, you know, said before, the whole target buy-in price is probably around 3,000 to 5,000. Now I might even, with like what's going on now, I might even lower that to 1,000 to 3,000, something like that, because the market's basically like, there's no interest, man. Nobody really gives a shit about crypto anymore. And there's a whole bunch of infighting basically going on right now. Like, there's what's called a hash war with the Bitcoin Cash community, which is the coin that I really like. However, now I'm like, it's just the community got split up, and like, it's just, it's a total mess. So basically what's happening is there's two camps. One camp that wants to basically keep the block size at 32 megabytes for Bitcoin Cash and introduce some new opcodes called like Data Sig Verify, which basically opens up a whole can of worms in terms of legality issues with Bitcoin, where they can make they can basically make gambling like right onto the blockchain, which is totally illegal and basically screws up everything that Bitcoin is, because Bitcoin's like supposed to be cash, it's supposed to be money. It's not supposed to be a platform for illegal gambling, and basically it makes it into what's called a bucket shop by law. So it really, like the guys on the one team are screwing things up, and then you have the other team, which is, so there's now like, so it's a mess. Like, I really liked Bitcoin Cash, and now like I still like it. I like one of the teams, but it's just, it's gotten to the point where it's so crazy, and like for an outsider looking in, you're just looking at this whole thing, it's like, it looks like a mess, you know, it looks like a shit show of just nobody knows what's going on. And I'd expect this to probably continue for another year until things really get straightened out. And on top of that, you have a lot of people within the market that are very, what I would call psyop, like they're very against one camp or the other. So like you have, you know, all sorts of, like basically wars going on about which Bitcoin Cash is better. And then like, on top of that, Bitcoin itself, there's a potential that Bitcoin itself could fail by next year, because there's rumors right now going on that that basically SegWit, which is the thing that a lot of people were opposed to in the Bitcoin Cash camp, could be corrupted, and there could be a bug that would kill off Bitcoin itself as we know it. So it's really an iffy market right now, and we've dropped from about 6,500, you know, a week ago. Now it's 5,529 as we're speaking right now. So it's really become a mess. And so like I said, there's basically Bitcoin Cash, which is the coin I like, because what they're doing and making Bitcoin, you know, a payment system, cash money, like that you can use to transact peer-to-peer, which is basically in the white paper when it was released in 2008. And so now you have two camps, and what they're doing is, what's happening is called a hash war, and basically it's the miners of each chain now, Bitcoin Cash ABC, and then Bitcoin Cash SV, which stands to Satoshi's vision. Basically, these guys are now going to be like mining and seeing who can get more power on which chain. And as of right now, a lot of people are thinking that ABC won, because, you know, a lot more of exchanges support it and whatever. But I think this is going to be a battle that goes on a lot more than just 2 or 3 days as it has now. Like, it's going to be basically, like, the one guy, the one side of the team on SV is basically, a lot of people call him fake Satoshi, because he, in 2014 or 2015, basically mainstream media doxed him as being Satoshi Nakamoto. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people in the industry don't actually believe that the guy is Satoshi Nakamoto, which, you know, personally, I don't know whether he is or not. He could very well be, but in my opinion, he is one of the smartest people and experts on the topic of Bitcoin. Like, when I hear anybody speak about Bitcoin, whether it be from the technical perspective, the fundamental perspective, or the economic perspective. Like, the guy really knows his shit. Like, you can listen to any one of his, you know, presentations, and, like, you know you're dealing with someone that really very well could have been there from the very beginning. And basically, a lot of people don't like this guy because he's a dick. Like, he...
Mm-hmm. Watch it. Whoa. Just some of the bad words. Some of the bad words.
Yeah, sorry. He's a prick. Basically, he's a prick. Like, mm-hmm. He's a loudmouth. He's very rude. But I like that about him, because it kind of reminds me of me, right? Like, I'm the same way, so I don't mind that. But mm-hmm. A lot of people in the cryptocurrency, I don't know, the area, they just seem to get, like, too emotionally attached to this. And they, you know, they just say, oh, fake Toshi. If he was real, he would sign his keys. What a lot of these people don't realize is the moment this guy publicly signs with, say, the first Bitcoin private key from the first transaction ever, mm-hmm. is the moment he's going to have hitmen, you know, tax authorities, this and that, coming after him. And whether or not he is Satoshi, it really doesn't matter, because at the end of the day, in my opinion, what that camp is going after and the goals that they're basically trying to achieve makes the most sense to me as someone who's been watching this market now for, you know, 3-4 years. And I think that it's really gotten to be a total mess, and like what's happening now is just, it's chaotic. And that's the thing, markets, as we all know, don't like uncertainty. So that's the reason why we're definitely kind of in this chaotic situation, where like the moment, it was basically a day before the hash wars. Which, for anybody listening that doesn't understand what a hash war is, it's just basically right now miners are competing with each other to see who can get more power onto which version of that Bitcoin, Bitcoin Cash, and basically, like, who's going to have the higher power chain. Because in Bitcoin, like, by the white paper, it's basically the miners rule. So, it's pretty much a total mess. And then on top of that, like, right, why I say it's going to probably be long and drawn out is because it could take, you know, a year, it could take months, it could take 2 years. Like, the people on the SV side said, like, they've already said that we're willing to mine at a loss for about 2 years before even thinking about, like, you know, switching things. And if you just do a quick Google search right now, like, you just type in Bitcoin Cash miners losing money. And if you see, like, right now, in order to mine either side of the chain, the people have to mine at a loss. Like, there's no profitability. So, like, Bitcoin is still profitable to mine because it costs about $3,300 to mine one coin. Right now, to mine one Bitcoin Cash ABC is $527. And the price of it on an exchange is just shy of, like, $280. Well, the article says 283. I think it's 260 today. And then Bitcoin Cash SV, the mining cost per coin is 249. And the price on an exchange currently is $138. Yeah. So these guys are mining at anywhere from, like, Bitcoin, the SV side is basically mining at a loss of about $250,000. And then the ABC side is mining at a loss of about $450,000.
It says right here, Bitcoin Cash ABC miners are losing twice as much money. And you see it here in these graphs. And you see the breakdown here of BC Cash SV and BC Ash ABC and Bitcoin here. So it's breaking down the 24-hour electricity, 24-hour coin worth, and the mining costs per coin. So you're definitely seeing double losses on some on that one specifically, like you just mentioned. And continue. I just got the article open for. I'm gonna leave this in the link for people to read, so people could read this link here. So continue.
Yeah. So basically, like, this war of hash wars, it could last a long time, because as of right now, the hash rate on both chains, SV and ABC. It's pretty much, it's almost at a tie. Like, ABC came out strong, but what they did was they rented hash from Bitcoin miners, which took away from the actual Bitcoin blockchain. And these guys basically, like, right now they're just, what about, maybe a point, like 0.2 or 0.4, maybe a half a petahash, where Bitcoin Cash SV is down, like, just a little bit. But they're starting to really become even. Going into the hash war, The SV side had more hash power, but now they're kind of like, they're getting close to even. When it started, like when this hash war started on the 15th, ABC came out strong. But like I said, this is one of those things that could really, really take a long time to figure out. And it's going to take the market to figure out. Like, it's going to be one of those things where people will have to decide who to go with. Personally, I'm in the SV camp because from what I've seen, what I've read, and the, you know, I've been studying this hard fork. And it's funny, too, because with this fork, how Bitcoin Cash split out, everybody thought, oh, I'm going to get free coins. I'm going to get free coins. So what happened the other week was Bitcoin Cash went from about $420. Within a matter of days, it was at $650. And then now it's crashed. And, you know, like before the split happened, I think the last trading price on Bitfinex for one Bitcoin Cash was about like $350 or $250. So it just crashed. It just shows you how irrational and how stupid this market is still, because people didn't understand that the split, like they thought it was going to be free money. Oh, I'm getting an airdrop. I'm getting free coins. Like how when Bitcoin last year split out into Bitcoin Cash. So like I said, for an outsider looking into this, it's just, it's a total mess. And
I got a question. You said a year. I got a question here from TJ Hammers asking, ask him about XRP, Mike.
XRP is a banker coin. I'm not really a big fan of that coin.
Okay, can you tell us? Yeah.
Just because of the community that like surrounds it, it's very, how you would say, like, it's just, it kind of, like the XRP community, I'm sure XRP, don't get me wrong, long term it may do well just because it is kind of tied into the bankers and the banking system.
Right.
But you have total idiots within the XRP community where a lot of these people, like, there's a meme going around where they say XRP by the end of the year will be $589, which is ridiculous. There is no way in hell that it'll ever go to that price at current rate, because then it would have a bigger market cap than Apple, Facebook, and all these other big actual companies combined. It's because the way people look at it, they think, oh, 50 cents, so it can go to 500. But no, not necessarily, because, like, let me just take a look here on CoinMarketCap. The circulating supply of XRP is 40 billion. Bitcoin has a circulating supply of 17 million, right? So you're looking at how many hundred times more of you know, supply. And then I'm not even sure if that's the total supply, because that's just what's circulating now. Like, these guys can basically introduce more coins. Yeah, their total supply is 100 billion.
That's a lot of supply, man. Holy Christ.
Yeah, it's like, it's almost like when you compare to a stock, right? Like, if there was a stock with that many circulating shares in the market, it would be way, way too much, 100 billion. And so that's the other thing. You know, Ripple right now, it has 40 circulating, and then there's another 59 billion that are held by the treasury or like the Ripple, you know, the Ripple company. So I don't trust the coin. I think it's banker coin. Like, I got into it at about, I don't know, 5 or 3 cents or something like that last year, early last year. And I sold it at 250 earlier this year. Like, the market went crazy and I sold it and I haven't looked back. And it personally, like, I'm not interested in this coin because it kind of goes against what cryptocurrency is about. It's definitely centralized. Like, the company, like the Ripple company, they basically have a lot of this, too much say within XRP. And the other thing is adoption. Like, I just don't see banks jumping onto XRP like everybody thinks they will. I could be wrong. It could very well do well. Like, right now, currently today, it's up 9%. It's one of the better performing coins in the market. So it's not bad, but it's not anything special. And it's definitely not going to go to $589 like the whole meme is circulating, because that would put the market cap at some ridiculous number. I'm not even sure. I'm not going to do the math now, but it just wouldn't make sense. You know, $10 in a couple of years, sure, maybe. So from 50 cents to $10, even to $5, that's a 10x, you know. But it's not something I like. I'm not a big fan of XRP. I think it's decent. Like, it's one of the faster coins on the market for sure, but it is what it is. Like, to me, it's just banker coin, and I don't trust, like, the banker guys, right? Like,
Yeah, like JP Diamond and JP Morgan, all those guys, once they get their fingers in it, it's all about profit margins. They don't care about anybody else.
Yeah, and these guys, see, the thing is, like, where people will, like, and that's the other thing, right? Like, if, say, someone from JP Morgan bought Ripple yesterday and they're up 8%, they won't even care because there's not enough liquidity on this market, for one. In order for someone like JP Morgan or Morgan Stanley or any of these guys to even sell it right now, like, whatever their position size is, I'd imagine it's quite a lot of XRP. And if these guys say they bought when Bitcoin was crashing the other day and they bought at 44 cents or 43 cents or whatever the low was, they're not going to hesitate to drop the, like, to start selling now, right? Because for traditional finance guys, 8% gain, like, you know how long that takes in stocks, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, like, that's what I think too is a big problem with crypto, with the cryptocurrency market now, is there's a lot of people that think we're going to get another bull run of 2017 proportions where everything just goes into mania and, like, an insane price rise, but it's just not going to happen. It's not going to happen for a while, and especially now with the whole, you know, Bitcoin Cash drama going on, markets do not like uncertainty. So it's just, we're in a really iffy situation. Like, I think personally, like I was saying last time I was on your show, is I think we're going to drop to 3,000 to 5,000, but now I'm thinking we might go even lower than that. Like, I think we might retest 1,300, 2,000, because that was like 1,300 and 2,000 last year were some of the price points that really were, I guess, what you'd call resistance. Like, I think January 2017, we hit 1,300 and then went back to 800. And then when we hit 2,000 for the first time, we went back to like 1,500 or maybe even back to 1,300. I would have to look at the chart, but it's like there's resistance points. And I guess, you know, old resistance becomes new support. So I'm thinking we might, if we don't hold 3,000 or 4,500, which as of right now, there's nothing telling me to buy this market. Like, it just looks so bearish on the longer frame charts. Like, the monthly chart looks awful.
Mm-hmm.
The week, like, the last week, the weekly chart for this week looks terrible. Like, we had barely any trading volume.
Mm-hmm.
And for instance, Coinbase, like I've talked about before, this is the main fiat on-ramp where people can trade with US dollars, you know, transfer from their bank account and start getting into Bitcoin. These guys right now are trading 4,500 Bitcoin in the last 24 hours. And the other day when we had the drop from, you know, 6,300, the trading volume was about like 40,000. So what we have right now is high volume on sell-offs and then low volume on recovery. So that's not really a recovery. In order for me to get bullish on this market, I'd have to see, you know, us go back to 6,000, 6,500 with like 50,000 traded or something like that, you know?
Yeah.
Something insane. And that's all I've noticed in the past couple of months, is that every time there's a high volume day, we dump. We don't see a pump. Like, there's no, the buy pressure is not hard and the sell pressure is hard. And then the other thing is, you still have people in this market that are, you know, up 5, 3, 4 times their money on certain coins. Like, even, like, there's a coin that I sold a long time ago that I was looking at today. It's about $1. When I sold it, it was like, you know, 15 or something like that.
Whoa.
And yeah. And even the thing is, even at $1, if I had held on to today, that thing would still be in profit because I was buying it at 50 cents, 40 cents.
I see what you're saying. Yeah.
So you know what I mean? Like, yeah. I would still be 2 times my money if I held on to that piece of crap.
Okay.
So there's lots of people like that, right? For instance, like, at the beginning of last year, Bitcoin was what? $1,000, $1,300, and then, you know, $2,000. So even if you got in at $2,000, which a lot of people did, you're still in massive profit. Ethereum at the beginning of last year was like what, $7, $10, something like that. Like, I remember buying a bit of Ethereum for cash and it was like $20, which was just dirt cheap. And now it's, you know, $178. So you're still in massive profit and you have these people. And on top of that, there's a really scary thing going on with Ethereum. Ethereum was the ICO platform, like where basically, you know, companies would raise money by selling their tokens for Ethereum. And the SEC put out some news the other day where basically they're starting to go after these companies where they're saying these coins, these initial coin offerings, are basically registered securities. So they just killed off the ICO market. Like,
whoa.
They're putting in a whole bunch of other risk into this market. And like I said, right now, like, things have gotten really, really crazy. So I'd probably even, you know, reduce my 3,000 to 5,000 target that I said before. Like, I'd probably reduce that down to, you know, anywhere from 1,000 to 4,000 to start buying. And I'm not even sure I'm gonna buy now. Someone said something funny, which is kind of sexist, but I laughed at it. It was basically like, I'm only gonna buy Bitcoin when all the female Bitcoin personalities delete their Twitter accounts, which is kind of true, because like, we had like the most average people that like don't really get tech come into this space, and they think, oh, it's gonna go up forever, but no, it's not.
No.
So like,
it's a market. Yeah. It's volatile. It's just like anything else, right?
Yeah, and then on top of that, like, you've had one of the greatest bubbles of all time. Like, imagine Ethereum went from, say, $10 at the beginning of 2017 to the end of 2017, it was trading at almost $1,400.
Mm-hmm.
What's that, a 4,000 or 5,000% gain? Where else do you get that in 1 year?
Never.
Nowhere.
Never. Oh, unless you buy a house in Vancouver.
Well, yeah.
I'm joking.
Not even close.
Yeah.
Actually, speaking of Vancouver, I've started to see some articles where the houses are really, like, a lot of houses are now going, like, remember we had a year ago, like, all those, you know, $1 million crack shacks. I've started to see those go now actually under a million, like 800,000, 700,000 for some of the worst ones, which is pretty cool. Like, that market's definitely going to crash. The thing with housing right now is we're nearing, in real estate, there's something called an 18-year real estate cycle, and
yes,
we're basically heading toward the end of the bullish phase of that.
Mm-hmm.
And on top of that, I've been basically, like, I trade stocks as well from time to time. I'm long-term, like, right now I'm mid to long-term bearish on, like, the S&P 500 and all that. I started shorting it in about September of this year. And I think 2019 for stocks, cryptocurrency, because like I said last time, cryptocurrency is a very speculative asset, and speculative assets do the worst in bear markets. So I'm not, like, don't get me wrong, I love crypto. I think it's the future of money, of finance, of all this. But as of right now, like, things are just starting to look worse and worse, man. And yeah, I think overall next year, like, we're going to see housing crash, financial markets crash. You know, we've already had this year a lot of the...
Hello? Are you there? Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I'm here. Hello?
Yeah, okay. So where do you think oil... Yeah. Where's oil going? Because I was dead wrong with oil. I believe oil is so severely undervalued. I picked up a lot of $2 stocks that were once at $50, $60 a stock. And they've even went down lower. So I was dead wrong with oil. Where the heck is oil going? Where's Canada's industry going to go with oil? Canada's finished. If we lose oil, where that's the nail in the coffin.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Oil, let me take a look at the chart, and I'll kind of give you my analysis of what I think the oil charts look like. But like I was saying, is what's going to happen in 2019 is very likely that we're going to see either a small recession or maybe even like a depression coming up, because what markets, basically all markets go into cycles, and there's a little, as weird as it sounds, a lot of people don't even believe me when I tell them these things, but astrological events 100% correlate to markets. And like, what's going to happen next year is basically the sun, it's going into a cycle of what's called the grand solar minimum.
Yes.
So basically the sun's going to be at the, like, it's going to get very cold in the next 5 years or so. And what happened was the last time we saw a grand solar minimum, I believe it was in the 1600s, somewhere around 1666.
Mini Ice Age. Mini Ice Age.
Yeah, funny enough that it was around 1666, you know, the whole 666 thing. Mm-hmm. But basically what happened back then in those 1600s, whatever markets were trading, like I've read this in a book, I think it might have been Cycles, like there's a book, it's basically called Cycles by some guy, Dewey. Mm-hmm. I forget, Edward Dewey maybe. It's just like, if you search Cycles by Dewey, you could probably find the book. But basically like what happened in those, in the 1600s were whatever markets were trading at the time of that last grand solar minimum, they went into an 86 year bear market. You know how long that is for a bear market?
Mm-hmm.
86 years. Not like, you know, a year what we've seen with the last, 2008 to 2009 before we saw a bottom. Not like the Great Depression of 1929 where, you know, it took 10 years to recover or whatever. 86 years of a bear market. Just insane. Okay, so with oil, what I see happening right now is the weekly chart looks very bearish. We might put in a temporary bottom here somewhere. Like, we might start to kind of trade sideways for a bit. But the monthly is really starting to look like it's going to cross over into negative territory. And if that happens, you're going to put in a very, very big, divergence. And it's just going to show a lot of weakness. So oil definitely has the potential to drop. Ooh. A lot. Like, I would see it dropping, you know, anywhere from, I don't know, maybe like 30 to 50%, something
Ooh.
Like that.
Oh, well, Canada's finished. If oil drops 30 to 50 points, that's our last major export that Canada depends on. All our pipelines, we have so much heavily invested into oil. Oh my God. Oh my goodness. Yeah,
well, that's the thing, right? Like I said, for me, like, I'm really very bearish overall on these markets. And the other thing is too, like, we have rise, like, there's just so many factors that you can combine with the markets right now. You know, you have the longest historical bull runs on, like, the spot on the S&P 500, on the Dow Jones. All these markets are just so overbought. Like, they've just been basically on a rally for, you know, 50 years. Like, even if you look at the S&P 500 or the Dow Jones right now, 2008, 2009, like, it's just a little blip in the radar. It really doesn't look like much, right? So there's potential for this stuff to really go down. And the other thing is, like, PE ratios are really out of whack. Like, a lot of these companies are trading way, way too high over, like, what their earnings are. So I don't know. I could see this stuff all just crashing down. And then, like, you know, obviously cryptocurrency would come down with it as well. But I could be wrong, but like I said, for me, like, from an astrological perspective, with the grand solar minimum coming and then certain other cycles, which I won't get into here, are basically, like, coming to ends, and then you combine it with other factors, interest rates, unease in the world, like, we might, like, with the way things are heading right now, like, we might head to World War III soon, just because, you know, what's profitable when business is at war?
Yeah. Business, you know, is... So. Well, that's what happened when you had mass unemployment in Italy in the 1930s. What did Mussolini do? Start a war, right? With Africa.
Yeah.
Right? Absolutely. What did the Japanese do? They started a war with Manchuria.
Yep.
So, what did Hitler do? He invaded Poland. So, I mean, when unemployment gets to a certain level, the division gets created, and then people take sides, and people, even the rich company, even those big army companies that make weapons, they supply both sides. They don't care who wins, right?
Yeah, so that's the thing. War has never been about, you know, fighting for what's right. It's always been about profit.
Yeah.
Every war is just a profit machine. That's all it is.
Yeah,
that's all it's like, you know, Yeah, it's pretty crazy too. And when you look at like the involvement of oil, going back to oil, like the involvement of oil companies, it's been a lot. Like, it's probably been 10 years since I've researched this, but like I remember there was a lot of money being made off of oil within World War II. And then obviously, you know, with Iraq and Afghanistan and all those Middle Eastern wars that we've seen in recent history, those are all about oil, right? So it's definitely like a profit machine, and that's what it is. So if there's anything to go long on here, you know, by what's that company? I forget. Lockheed Martin. Yeah, that's probably a good guy.
Okay.
You know. Okay. Other than that, but even then, like, that could all come crashing down too.
For sure. For sure. Okay, Anthony, I'm gonna let you go. Thank you for the crypto updates and your market analysis on where things are headed. I appreciate it very much. We'll have you on the show again in the future. Okay.
Yeah. Sounds good, buddy. God bless.
God bless you. Good night.